also the puzzle is part of one of the symbols that's inside the book, that is a learning tool in which you use the visual to connect with the language. And each piece works like a Lego piece. Each piece has its own meaning. The maze, the child in the middle, the hair is the spirit, the hand is the harvest, and the magenta piece is the earth. This is the Hoya de Seren UNESCO World Heritage Site. In our only World Heritage Site, Maya, in El Salvador. And the narratives and stories found in this book were temporarily painted on the building by the community and the children of Hoya de Seren. And this is the Pan American Games inauguration uniforms, in which my fellow Salvadorans and athletes selected from nine animals of the mythological underworld. And they wore the powers of each of the animals, the turkey, the fish, and the dog. And so now, after a brief introduction to one of the practitioners in the Indigo Network, that is me, we're going to introduce the International Indigenous Design Charter panel discussion, in which we have, yes, Ellie, Jifa, myself, please Dr. Dori Tunstall from Canada, Oka, Patrick Stewart, Niska, please come up from Canada. Kevin Poitras, Philippe Milieu, and Cheyenne. You're all welcome to our populated panel.
Thanks, Rita. Rita is the chair of the Supreme Ambassador, as you mentioned, for the Indigo for many, many years, and a great champion of the initiative. And Rita is also the Indigenous chair of the Indigenous Advisory for the Indigo project as well. So let's open up for some discussions. Douglas has just popped out for an interview and apparently will be back to join the panel as well. So hopefully. That's a quick interview. But what we'd like to do is just start open up for discussion. If anyone's got any questions about anything that's been discussed, whether it's about the design advocacy as Jennifer has represented, or whether it's about the Indigo Project or the Charter or work from local Indigenous designers in Canada. So has anyone got a question to start with? If you do have a question, if you don't mind coming down to the microphone here at the front. And then we're going to have to hand that microphone over to the panel. So it's going to be a little bit of a disturbing.
Hi, thanks for presenting today, it was great. I'm a First Nations person from Northern Ontario. And one of the major issues that we're having in Canada is cultural loss, that the elders are passing away and not passing on that knowledge. Is there any way that you've used design as a tool to help communities pass on some of that knowledge to future generations?
Who would like to respond?
My experience is the ability to transfer Indigenous knowledge can in fact be done within design spaces. And so in my sort of cultural practice, what we've endeavoured to do is to sort of embed motifs, references and stories within our projects. And what that does is it begins a conversation where we can start to pass on and share knowledge through this notion of knowledge exchange, and also to broaden the conversation. So for instance, an example is, we did a project at a university, and the project was a landscape design, and it incorporated public art and urban design, and also communication design. But the genesis of the idea was around the seven seasons of the Kulin Nation. And so in Australia, we tend to adopt the European construct of four seasons. Well, if you've ever lived in Melbourne, you'd know there's definitely more than four seasons. We have four seasons in one day. But the seven seasons of the Kulin Nation, what that enabled us to do was to connect to sort of connection to plant materials, to look at specifically our bioregion, to showcase medicinal plants, edible plants, plants used for weaving. And then we had pedagogical panels to interpret that space, and then also to demonstrate that cultural continuity and that Indigenous culture has not been lost by the concrete jungle that is a major metropolis, and that we can reveal layers of history and meaning within a project. And then by engaging with traditional owner groups, which we did, we can then embed within the DNA of the project a connection to culture. And so that then becomes a mechanism to open up a conversation. And then what we also did is we put a fire pit in the centre. So at the start of every academic year, the welcome to country, which is a smoking ceremony, occurs on that site. And it also becomes the ceremonial site for the adjacent Indigenous unit. And so then what it enables us to do is showcase culture, a lived culture. And so it also enabled a place of respite and contemplation within a sort of busy metropolis and university environment. And so that sort of soft landscape, which is actually telling a story, and then embedded within the horizontal plane of the paving, we embedded particular motifs and cultural references as well. So you can see it can be done in subtle and nuanced ways, but it can be quite overt as well. And so by then engaging particularly with Indigenous stakeholders, then we can start to infuse it with a particular sensibility.
Can you just also tell the story of the smoking pit?
Yes, this is a classic story. So because we were proposing to put a fire pit into this project, the university started to get very nervous. And so they commissioned an 80-page report from a fire engineer to explain all the reasons why we can't have a fire pit. And then what we wanted to reinforce is, well, you do understand that a smoking ceremony requires the burning of a leaf which smokes, so it's a green leaf. So there's no open fire as such. And so then it was all about the nomenclature. So they changed the language and rebranded it. Rather than calling it a fire pit, they called it a leaf smouldering platform. And so the moment that they changed the language, it was all okay.
Thanks for the question. I'm Patrick Stewart. I'm from practicing in BC. It depends on, I guess, community involvement. So in projects that are community-based, it's really, you know, up to the community how much involvement they want. But, you know, from elders to school children can have input. And to me, it's good buy-in into the project. It's their project. It becomes their project. And it's a way of leaving the legacy in the community. And I think they have a way of, showcasing their own knowledge or you know, holding it up in their own way. And it is the one way that ensures that the project has a life of its own and becomes its own thing.
Hi, I'm Cheyenne Thomas. I'm from Pegwis First Nation in Manitoba. I'm Ojibwe. So one of the projects my dad and I have been working on is called the Indigenous Garden. So it's this massive garden in Winnipeg that is all European, very manicured land and walkways in it. So they wanted to renovate the whole garden or the whole park and make it indigenous. So they asked my dad and I to come up with a way that we could have a design process. So we had 3 different workshops that were day long, and we had elders, we had youth, we had all spectrums of the indigenous community in my city come and have ceremonies in the park and like come to a spiritual, a common ground, like through songs. And then from that process, we moved forward with ideas where it was, everyone was humble and thinking the same way. And from that, we came up with, the whole park had these principles. The youth were the most important. And from that, we had food, a place where people can gather and learn from elders in an outdoor kitchen. And then also from that, we had a fire, a welcoming fire, because that's a way of welcoming people into your territory and recognition of the actual tribes that are there. And then, so the process was, I think, like 7 months. And from that, we've covered, refined the principles that the elders wanted there through ceremony and consultation.
Drag this over to a degree. Well, it can't stick to the floor, but we get there.
Great use of Velcro.
As an Australian, and probably a very white one at that, I had to travel to pretty much the opposite side of the planet to discover the great work in Indigenous design that is being done in my own country. Is that a common experience, and why does the panel think that is the case?
I think a large part of it has to do with the numbers. There's so few of us. It's only been 2 years, I think, since we've started an Indigenous task force here in Canada as part of the REIC. And before that, it was hit and miss who you knew. It was personal relationships, and that was how our network started. So there's very few people. I've met a few Australians, Aboriginal Australians from Canada, and we've networked that way, and I've gone over there, but there's just a handful, right? So I think the charter and what the new initiatives that are coming about, it'll grow. People will become more aware. Just since our task force has started, there's been a lot more, I guess, publicity about who we are and what we do. But we've, you know, sort of opened up the lines, as it were, between Canada and the U.S. and, you know, trying to dissolve the medicine line and say, look, we all are together, and, you know, we're trying to establish networks that way as well. So, but it's a growing thing. It's going to take time.
You've already said Dory would probably give a good perspective on this, given since she's lived in Australia and Canada and the US.
This spring we had an audit. So I'm the Dean of Design at OCAD University, so Ontario College of Art and Design in Toronto. This spring we had an audit of our core and required courses in all of our 6 undergraduate programs to identify, and part of that exercise was a self-reflection on the presence of Indigenous content and Indigenous principles in the curriculum, and then the presence of content and or principles related to racialized communities. And what was interesting in our discovery was that actually there was a fair amount of Indigenous content, but it was from Peru or from somewhere else or from Australia. That what was actually missing was the engagement with our local Indigenous communities. And so kind of in the discussion, you know, trying to tease out kind of why that was that there was a general understanding of the importance of indigeneity, but there was a sense of anxiety, might be the right word, in terms of that engagement with the local Indigenous communities with whom you are implicated in sort of the colonial settler relationship, right? And so I think in terms of again, as an institution whose role it is to present knowledge, that meant our students, right, were receiving an education that was, again, spoke to ideals and the importance of indigeneity, but was not locally based. Now, as a dean, that makes my job easier in the sense that it's just making those relationships and the connections to the local indigenous communities. And since they're local, you can bring them in and you don't have to arrange flights from Australia, which are really expensive, all these sort of things. But again, it just shows the gaps, right? That the gaps that exist in the terms of sort of the readiness and the willingness in which, again, this being faculty members who consider themselves kind of quite open in many ways in a city which is very diverse like Toronto, that the challenges they present for themselves, I would say, in terms of being able to engage with the implications of their being there and what it means for making and what it means for design and what it means for their relationship to the land and what it means that they're transmitting to the students.
Good question, sorry.
That a little bit further, if I may. Firstly, it's not the cost of coming here, it's just a bloody long way, that's all. But can I extend that a little bit further? Because being from a non-Indigenous background, how do you feel about non-Indigenous peoples in that space, generally? I know that if we follow protocols, that's one thing, but how do you generally feel about non-Indigenous peoples in the Indigenous space as a challenge?
Don't hold back.
Ideally, projects are Indigenous-led in the first instance. But the reality is, because there are so few practitioners out there, that we need to have mechanisms like the Charter as a vehicle or as a framework to empower non-Indigenous people to be involved in this space. So there's far too many projects which interface with Indigenous culture for the expectation that Indigenous people can lead them all. And so it's incumbent on us to provide the toolkit to enable people to meaningfully engage with Indigenous culture with particular projects. But ideally, what we're wanting to do through this process is to empower community and to enable more people to come through to see the value proposition of what being involved in the design sector can add to amplifying connections to culture. And so this is where it becomes a really interesting role of education to also start to normalise a connection to Indigenous knowledge systems, to build cultural competency, to enable content to be part of the experience of the design schools. So all of it is actually part of the mix.
It's just a very small, it's a very small thing that I would add to all of that, is that there will be an instance, and not, you know, it's not a huge instance, but there will be a small time when the Indigenous people will need to talk amongst themselves. There'll be things that need to be covered that don't necessarily need to be heard by anybody else, don't necessarily need to be acted on by anybody else. There's certain things that we hold very sacred that we don't want to pass on, and we'll pass on in a very nondescript way so as not to bring some attention to that. That happens through design, it happens through artwork, it happens through everyday life, it happens through conversations over a cup of tea or coffee that we keep quite secret, really. So there will be times when that's present, and there will be times when it's quite vocal, and the non-Indigenous people in the arena will be asked if they could step aside from that conversation so that clarity can be formed before we continue on or move forward.
Oh, sorry, I scratched that. Any other comments?
What Jeffa said and Ellie said was very good, and I appreciate your words, Ellie. And I think it's so
new for Indigenous designers to be finding a voice, I suppose. So it's been a long history of, you know, colonialism, and projects have been happening for generations, really. And, you know, there have not been, you know, Douglas, who you've all heard, he was our first architect in this country, that is First Nations, and it's only, you know, since the 60s that he's started practicing. So it's a very small impact in a sense. We're still trying to find our footing in the profession and finding a voice. And, you know, and what Ellie says about having, you know, a time for ourselves is quite true. There's a comfort, I think, in being able to just talk among ourselves sometimes. And I think that just gives confidence to what we're thinking, what we have to say.
Can I just build on that point? The comfort you're talking amongst yourselves, but what about the benefit of an international dialogue with Indigenous people? And perhaps Frieda and Ellie, from your experience meeting the Sami and Inuit people in Sweden and Greenland, probably. Could you just add a bit to that?
There was definitely a great degree of comfort in sitting with people across the world, and the similarities are incredible. And I think in those similarities, we draw a lot of knowledge from each other. And the fact that all of these things are, they run parallel. And we didn't know that. And if we stay in our own little spheres, we don't get to see that. And we don't get to be touched by the comfort and the warmth and the knowledge from another culture, which is so close to our own. And it was life-changing for me to go overseas and sit with these other people, and this is equally as life-changing. It gives me a new perspective. It gives you a new platform to stand on that you probably never thought would ever come. But in that, the self-empowerment of that is incredible. And with self-empowerment, it creates magic, and things that the offshoots of those sorts of things, of meeting people of like-mindedness and of like culture, it's almost lost for words. It's more of a feeling and more about about your essences and how important the essences are, and that we're all connected to country, and ultimately it's the one land. Just broken up into many, many pieces. And I feel I came from the stolen generations within the Australian system. And so the sense of belonging was very missing in my very early years. But it's somewhat renewed with meeting people of like-mindedness.
Yeah, I believe also it's healing to have the reflection of Indigenous peoples from different regions of the world, different communities come together. We are a reflection of each other, and like Douglas said, we're all interconnected. And the origins of the world are not that complicated. It's a simple way of living that we have made very complex by all the layers we've added. And so, but the Indigenous ethos and the Indigenous cosmovision is almost the same. Our experience in New Zealand too, that
yeah.
We share. One more minute. We shared an Indigenous Design Conference last year, and it was a conference, but we were all communing we were, you know, it was the communal space of the Maori and Marae, and we all, you know, camped on the floor. We went to bed together. We rose together. We acknowledged place together, and so that was that is a different way of experiencing and seeing things, I think.
I was just going to add, because we constantly get asked, what is indigeneity, what is indigenous, and I kept thinking about it, but what unites or unifies us all is that we have such a strong spirit to our connection and the land, and when we're, I think, in our art or our design work, it's just like a reflection of our connection to that, and we're always seeking like the truth in things and the spirit in things, and that's when we met in New Zealand.
I just wanted to add to that in the sense that there's really two different things that I discovered with all of you when we were in New Zealand, which was that, yeah, we have this sort of shared, to me it was very surprising coming from Montana, coming from my reservation on the Crow Nation, and feeling a connection to Maori. Like, I didn't even think there'd be any connection to these Pacific Islanders. Like, what would there be? And there is that sort of shared idea of connection to the earth and philosophy is very strong. But also, I think very importantly, the connection is we were all colonized. We all went through extraordinarily similar processes of our land being taken, of our language being taken, and of our children being taken. Just last night, I learned that both Ellie and Patrick were stolen from their parents. And they're on opposite sides of the earth and they're sharing the same story. When we get together and we learn these stories, it's like, I think it's kind of scaring the world when the colonizers realize the colonizers aren't to talk to each other. And we're realizing that, whoa, we've all gone through this. And now we're trying to figure out what to do about it and how to respond and how to regain our voices. And I think it's wonderful that we're really building on that dialogue and that these international exchanges are powerful.
Great. So any other question?
Yeah, there's a question about here.
From the
Commonwealth.
Hello. I just had a question, maybe in terms of the architecture or the architects, in terms of the scale of like your projects, in terms of this charter, your own personal beliefs, do you ever reject a project just based on the scale of the project? Like, is it almost reflective of Western values, the scale that the project wants to attain?
There's no project too small or too big that cannot be indigenized. That's my starting premise. But I think importantly, it's about trying to find a way where it can be meaningful. So often we're asked to engage with a particular project, and I tend to ask three questions from the outset. And the first one is, who have you engaged with? How far along the process are you? And what ideas have you embedded through the design thinking to embed Indigenous aspects? And so it's quite common in terms of the feedback that I receive at this point and this sort of juncture of a conversation is, it's often a case of, well, we haven't spoke to any traditional owner groups yet. I'm about to pour the foundations, and perhaps we could hang an Indigenous painting in the foyer. And then my response at that point is, well, nice idea that you wanted to embed some ideas around Indigenous culture into your project, but I don't think this is the one, and you've kind of engaged too late in the process. So is there another way? And so that's the important starting conversation, is to understand the process, the methodology. And this is why having Indigenous practitioners involved in the process, you can often circumvent these issues that one confronts, because it's going to be flagged, and it's going to be flagged early. And it's not going to be an afterthought or a sort of an applique on the surface of the building. It becomes something which is embedded within the DNA of the project. So this is, I guess, my sort of philosophical standpoint is it's driven by the process. And the end product, the artifact which we tend to privilege, is a byproduct of an experience and a journey which has gone on together with community.
But there have been projects that I've sort of refused to engage in. One is franchises, for example, just because of the structure of the program that they give. I just don't know what others think, but that's kind of project that I've refused to do. Any prison work, I also refuse to do, because incarceration rates of Aboriginal people is quite high, and I just can't see working on that. And the other one was casinos. That's very too much community money goes into those things, I think. But so those are just sort of personal, I guess, values that I look in, and when somebody approaches me on a project, look at it. There is one other sort of building type I don't do, and that's houses, individual houses. Not that if I could find a good client, it might be good, but I had a bad experience of a fighting husband and wife that made it a nightmare. I thought, I'm never going to do another house. The wife would tell me one thing, and the husband would come the next day and say, don't listen to the thing she said. And I had to sit them down, and it's like, I was a marriage counselor. I said, you guys can't do that to me. How am I supposed to design your house when each one of you tells me not to listen to the other?
Can I extend that question or your comment a little bit further and just put it to Mr. Douglas Cardinal?
Yep.
Are there any projects you refuse to do, and on what basis would that be?
Well, I've always put out there where I was coming from, and that is making a contribution to people in a good way, and doing it in the process that I'm working on, like I wouldn't do a building that was top-down planning where you're designing, say, a college only with the input of the hierarchy in the college. I mean, the only way I would design any building is if it actually involved totally the users in the design process. And it was done really in an Indigenous way, which is fundamentally getting everybody working together in a circle and respecting everybody that I was working with, and having the vision come from the people themselves. Like, I feel it's pretty arrogant to come in and say, well, I will provide you a vision for your community, when I feel that you actually have to humbly approach the people you're serving and saying, my job is to bring your vision into reality. If some client said, well, give me a design, you know, give me one of your designs, and I'll build them, I'll say, how can I do that? Doesn't come from the people. Like, I'm not a designer. Like, you know, this design, we could just take this design, I really like that design, why can't we build that? In this community, no. It has to grow from people's needs. And so that's, so I only follow my process, and people who don't like my process, well then they go to some other architect.
But, you mentioned before the training to not be fearful, and for someone of your reputation, I assume people listen to you most of the time. What about when you were a younger designer, when you were actually an architect starting out in the 60s and 70s? How did you, were you born with that courage, or is that something you learned, or is it something that you you managed over a period of time to work with clients, basically?
Well, I think I had such a solid foundation from my elders and my own family that I never bought into colonialism. So this whole thing about that you have to follow the rules, you have to do this, you have to do that according to some kind of rules. I mean, I always questioned everything. So I think that yet even, as Socrates said, rules are guides for scholars strictly adhered to by fools. I think that the good thing, the crooked good of this society is when somebody marginalizes you and makes you a non-person, and because you're born that you don't fit at all into the society, and if you don't fit into society at all because of the racism in this country, you know, that's a tremendous advantage. Because if you don't fit into society, you question society, and you're not ruled by society because they have no impact on you because you don't belong to society. So then that gives you a freedom that no other person has in that society that belongs to it.
That's some great advice for our young designers. Philippe, I've just got a question. We've a lot of discussion over our presentation involved in the charter as a cultural mediating tool. And I know you've been working, and you mentioned earlier this morning about your role as an interlocutor, I guess, between cultures. So I'm just wondering whether you could expand on how that works for you and what's required in the future to improve that relationship between non-Indigenous and Indigenous.
Well, see, my elders have always taught me there's only one race, that's the human race. And so it doesn't matter, like if you're taught that the trees, the animals, the birds, the fish, the water, they're all your relations. And definitely people are all your relations. And we don't have a dualistic culture, like good and bad, right and wrong and all that. We don't objectify things. Like when we're sitting in front of a human being, they're not they and me. They're an extension of me. So you're looking at another human being that, in the sense that they're no different than you. And if you start judging them, that is arrogant. So you have to approach another human being with a little bit of humility, with an open heart, because they're another magnificent being of creation, and so you have to respect them. And so you look at that as a way of just embracing everyone. We're all the same. We're all Indigenous people from somewhere. It's just people, us, their connection with their land and their connection with each other. And as an Indigenous person, I always feel a little sorry that they have come from that place. And so it's like, if anything, I feel that people that don't have the same deep roots and deep connection with the land and deep connection to the other, they require much more consideration, much more love, and much more openness and caring.
Would you like to make comment?
Yeah.
I think we come from the same kind of family of thought, me and Douglas. So my background is I'm Mohawk from Mississauga, the community who went through the last armed conflict with the government of Canada. So I come from a place of seeing what war can look like right in our community. We had the army there. We had as many soldiers as in Afghanistan right on my doorstep. I heard the gunshots when it started all in 1990, and I was a kid. After that, I played around in a war zone as a kid, and we hanged out with the warriors and went to the barricades because they were our friends. And then finally, we were a displaced family. So I come from a very particular identity where I see how easy it could be to have colonization become something much more in this country. And I think Canadians are lucky that Indigenous people actually haven't picked up on the warrior path from the Mohawks. That being said, my identity is one of being humanist. And so I believe that human beings are always learning new ways, and they can be learning horrible, awful ways of being collectively narcissistic psychopaths, or we can be learning how to be kind in all the chaos that's out there. And so I think my role as a person that comes from two different genetic backgrounds, my Mohawk ancestry on my mom's side, my French Quebecois white ancestry on my dad's side, it gives me a particular role to play where I have to consider both sides at all times, and I have to consider my foundational beliefs that if Indigenous people are to become what they are, all sides have to come to the table. As of right now, we have little to no power. Colonizers have most of it. I myself am in a position of privilege, in fact, because I look white. I'm a tall, white, bilingual man in Quebec, Montreal. I'm literally probably at the best place a human being can be to choose his own path and affect change. So my role is to be a peacemaker, an educator, a bringer of different perceptions together. So that's why I specialize in communication. And that's why I wanted to do something like the Expo and bring as many different people around that process. And as an executive director of a friendship center, our goal is to be status blind, there for all Indigenous people, not standing your status or which nation you're from, or if you're more French speaking or English speaking, and if you have Indigenous family members or not, and if your kids are of mixed roots. So the whole thing boils down to how we're going to work together. And if we're going to learn from each other, and that has to be done on the international, national, local, individual stage. So that's how I take it.
Terrific. And that's probably an appropriate place to finish, unless there's any further questions or comments from the group.
I'll just interlude there and just say, Philippe, you're doing an excellent job in this role. You're an incredible man. We've only just met you in the past few days, but it's admirable what work you do.
Thanks.
Hi, I present myself as Julien. I'm a Métis too. I'm a Wasakik Maliseet from Montreal, even though it's not our ancestral territory. And I find myself in exactly the same position as you, Philip. Is that I have a father Quebec father, a white man, and I have a native indigenous mother. And I always find myself in the middle of this, and I don't know where to go. And I don't know if any of you are in the same situation, but I would like to know how you deal with that, if you have to, and what are your solutions to make this happen, make these cultures talk together and communicate together. I don't know if it's clear.
So we face this a lot in our Friendship Center. Most Indigenous people living in cities either have lost their culture, they're rekindling their culture, they're figuring out how Indigenous do I want to be? Do I want to be a traditional, contemporary kind of Indigenous person? And my response to that is, it's really up to you. And nobody should ever tell you you're not Indigenous enough or you're too Quebecois. If you want to be you as an individual, before you as a nation, a tribe, a this or that, that can be a good starting point. And I think that's the big challenge for young Indigenous people is, well, do I have to represent the Maliseet Nation then? Do I have to learn my language? I don't speak Mohawk. I can say Sego, Niwen, Ona. And for right now, that's enough for me. And I'm non-spiritual. I'm a very, very atheist kind of guy. Doesn't mean I'm not going to defend our rights for spirituality and culture and all these kinds of things, but I myself, well, I'm not the guy you're going to see dressed up in regalia at a powwow, but I'm going to be hosting the powwow instead. So I think it really comes from that individual mandate you give yourself way above the rest, and the rest will follow. And it's living it too, challenging yourself with those notions. And I think we all face those kinds of things day to day.
Well, my father is Blackfoot. My mother is German and Métis. But the reason, and my mother was a registered nurse and very successful young woman at that time, head of a hospital. Why did she choose my Anishinaabe father? Because he respected and honored. And they got together because of the values they shared, and the values was loving and caring. And so I then was brought up with those values, and I find those values as the heart and center of our Anishinaabe culture. And the more I in depth that I embraced my Anishinaabe culture, the more I realized why my mother chose my father.
Sorry, I know you're waiting for a question. I found the easiest way was to be the best me I could be, the strongest man I could be, and that can change at any given time. But the most important thing for me was to be the person that my children could look up to and to give them a role within their society that had no negativity about who they were. I wanted them to be very proud Aboriginal people. They're lighter skinned than I am because their father was an Australian man. He was quite crazy. Hence we're not anywhere near together now, but they still have his ancestry as well as mine. They chose to, yes, acknowledge that ancestry, but be of my ancestry. And my son once said to me, I'm choosing this because I'm the warrior. I am a warrior and I will be a warrior. And that sort of terminology isn't normally in, or wasn't actually at all, in the ancestry of his father. But he saw a strength in you know, his Aboriginal culture. strength and our fragility as well, that he can be, you know, a nice, calm, gentle man, but a warrior when needed. So I think within us, we sort out eventually our path because it presents itself to us time and time again until we listen, really.
Thank you. I'm the granddaughter of a white settler uninvited guest of Treaty Number 6 in Canada. And so my question is really directed to the Canadians on the panel. But what I see as, and I understand the Indian Act is a double-edged sword where it protects Indigenous culture, but it also has imposed a genocide and a history that is appalling. So how do we go forward from that? How do you view that as, do you embrace that? How do we use that? How do we dismiss that? Because really it does protect, but it also degenerates our country and our us as people and us as designers.
The Indian Act does not protect the people. The government does not protect the people by making them wards of the state. The Indian Act is designed to take away the rights, take away the land, take away the traditions, take away everything, so that there is no one to be able to contest the stealing of the land that for thousands of years belonged to sovereign nations. So the government of Canada is not protecting the people. The government of Canada is annihilating the Indian people. And so it is only the people themselves that have stood up and being able to support themselves. And through this terrible, terrible apartheid and genocide in the last 50 years, have our Indigenous people survived. And in their survival, they become stronger, more resilient, and now they're the fastest growing population in Canada. And they will need their resilience and strength of their own culture to survive. And when you get rid of the Indian Act, which is apartheid and genocide, and a crime against humanity as defined by the United Nations, we'll be able to have self-governing people who originally, according to treaties, would be partners to the rest of the immigrant culture that came here. That is something that I've fought all my life, and it is something that has to change. So it's unfortunate that the government of Canada has created this situation where they think they're looking after our people, or we're in trouble. You know, like we're the problem. We're not the problem. It's the people who have colonized us and our land that are the problem. But and it was told to me. I was at a dinner at the museum with the Japanese embassy. There was a big celebration of Japanese Canadians. And the ambassador turned to me and he says, I'm leaving this country now. I've been here a long time and I really love this country. I've traveled everywhere. But for the life of me, he says, and that's after he invited his drummers and also our Indigenous drummers to the celebration there at the museum. He said, for the life of me, how can the people of Canada allow a communist state within a democracy? A communist state for our Indigenous people in a democracy. How can this country allow that? And so I returned and said, "Now, dear, you should say this, you know, that we're a guest in this country." And I said, "No, it's refreshing that you tell me the truth and that you see it as another nation being an ambassador from Japan."
Thank you, Douglas. Douglas, that's some sobering thoughts to leave us with, and something we can all carry with us with our future development of these initiatives. So thank you very much. I'd like to draw the presentation to a close, if that's all right, unless there's anything that anyone particularly wants to say.